Good morning. Welcome to Northwoods. We're really glad you're here today. Pray that we'll have a great day as we worship the Lord. And so grateful that you're here. So make yourself right at home. If this is your first time here, just kick your shoes off. I don't mean that. But no, I'm kidding. Just make yourself right at home. We're really, really glad you're here. And if this is your normal place of worship, we're glad you're here as well. Hey, if you have a bulletin, I'd ask you to grab it. Inside of it, you're going to find a Connect card. And I'd ask you to fill the very front of the Connect card out. We'll put this in the offering boxes on our way out. And there are some opportunities in the next few moments to put some things on the back of your Connect card to let us know some ways that you may be able to connect with the different ministries of our church. If you're watching online, we're grateful that you're there. And you can also participate with the Connect card by texting the word connect to 812-214-1987. So I'm going to give you some announcements, and there's a specific theme that I've noticed looking at the announcements that I'm going to give. Let's see if you can pick it up. You ready? The first one is, on this coming Wednesday, we have a men's breakfast and Bible study that is going to be at 6:45 this coming Wednesday. 6:45. Breakfast is a form of what? Food. Food. So men are going to have some food on this coming Wednesday at 6:45. Then next Sunday, we have a Northwoods class. Northwoods class is an opportunity for us to learn more about Northwoods. If you're looking to learn more about Northwoods, potentially join Northwoods, this is a great opportunity for you to come and find out more about Northwoods. You can sign up for this on the back of the Connect card. And we're going to, if you sign up for it, we're going to feed you lunch. And lunch is a form of what? Food. And what's coming down the pipe is Fall Festival. Fall Festival booth. And we have a Fall Festival booth that we're needing some help in manning. And if you're interested in helping us man the Fall Festival booth, it's going to be there. We do walking tacos and that type of thing. And this is shocking, but guess what's at the Fall Festival? Food. Yes, exactly. Grain sandwiches. God bless America. Yeah. So that's what's going on there. 55 Club has a fellowship coming, and that is going to be held at the Log Inn. At the Log. I'm not even on the 55 Club, and I may show up at this. Okay? I'm 4 years away from the 55 Club. But anyhow, I may show up at this. Tuesday, September the 28th at 6 p.m., we would encourage all of you to participate, but they are wanting to know through the Connect card who's coming, and you get to go to the login and eat some food. And this coming Thursday, we are doing a sort of a community outreach with North High School football team as we feed the North High School football team some food. Yes, do you see a theme that's going on as I look at every one of these announcements? And if you're able to help us with the North High School feeding, you can also check that on the back of the Connect card and say, yeah, we'll help feed the North High School football team. I am 100% confident that they can eat. So know that. And then almost the last announcement I have is we have an evangelism conference coming on October the 29th and 30th, Friday night the 29th from 6 to 9, and then 9 to noon on October the 30th. Dr. Chuck Kelly, former president of New Orleans Baptist Theological Seminary, Dr. Mark Tolbert is going to be here, seminary professor at New Orleans Baptist Theological Seminary. So I was trying to think, is food related to this? And then it hit me. At noon on Saturday, before you leave, we will be feeding you food. Yes, everything that relates to Northwoods, somehow or another, food is related. God bless America. Okay? And so let me finish the announcements by reminding you we are encouraging you to keep track of gospel conversations. And if you are having any gospel conversations, you can let us know on the back of your Connect card. You can also let us know by dropping a ping pong ball for every gospel conversation in our display out in the lobby area. When the service is over with today, you can put your offering in the offering boxes as you leave. And for those of you who give online, you can participate through our online giving through northwoodschurch.org/giving. And those of you who choose to text to give, you can also do that as well by texting the word give to 812-214-1987. So today, our service order is a little different because we will be, by the end of the service today, we will be participating with the Lord's Supper. We'll be participating with communion. And so you can be thinking about that as we move through the service today. Let's put our mind on the Lord, and let's go to the Lord in prayer. Would you bow with me as we pray? Father, I love you. I thank you for loving us. I'm grateful for your word, which tells us that you loved us before we could ever love you. You demonstrated your love towards us, and that while we were still sinners, you died for us. I pray that, Father, today, before this service is over, we would recognize that, Lord, you are greater. There is no comparison to anything to you. You're superior. You're worthy to be worshipped. No matter what burdens we have brought into this room, you're larger. So, Lord, I come to you today, and I ask you that you would minister to us. May there be a forgiveness of sin. May there be, for those who don't know you, may there be salvation given. Lord, today, may we worship you well. Help us that, Lord, we be reconciled to you. Thank you for your faithfulness. In Jesus' name, amen. Would you stand with me as we sing to the Lord today?
There's no one greater than the Lord, no one better than him. Let's sing this.
I searched the world, but it couldn't fill me. A man's empty praise and treasures that fade, never enough. Then you came along and put me back together, and every desire is now satisfied here in your love.
There's nothing better.
Oh, there's nothing better than you. There's nothing better than you, Lord. There's nothing, nothing is better than you. I'm not afraid to show you my weakness.
God never fails, and we can count on Him. Sing this, I'll trust you, Lord.
I count on one thing, the same God that never fails will not fail me now. You won't fail me now in the waiting. The same God who's never late is working all things out. You're working all things out. Yes, I will lift you high in the lowest valley. Yes, I will bless your name. Yes, I will sing for joy when my heart is heavy all my days. Oh, yes, I will.
Count on one thing, God never fails.
I count on one thing, the same God that never fails will not fail.
Praise the Lord at those times, because the Lord is our refuge and He holds us in His hands. I'm singing one more song. Nahum 1:7 says, "The Lord is good. He's a refuge for those in trouble. He cares for those who trust in Him." And if you're in that place, maybe you're in the lowest valley, maybe you're on the highest highs, whatever, the Lord has you in His hands. He holds you. This song says, He will hold me fast.
When I fear my faith will fail, Christ will hold me fast. When the tempter would prevail, He will hold fast. I could never keep my hold through life's fearful path, for my love is often cold. He must hold me fast. He will hold me fast. He will hold me fast, for my Savior loves me. Christ will hold me fast, precious.
This morning, would you take them and turn with me to the book of Hebrews, chapter 1. Hey, Ty, would you mind bringing that board out for me? Thank you. Hebrews, chapter 1. We started a series a couple of weeks ago going through the book of Hebrews, calling the series Greater Than. And today we're starting and we're picking up in Hebrews, chapter 1, in verse number 4. Our world, I believe, is fascinated with angels. And there's a lot of misunderstandings about angels. In the Bible, when an angel appears, it's not cuddly. It's not cute. It's always alarming. When an angel appears, their first statement is generally, "Fear not," because when you see it, you're shaking in your boots. Michael Landon played an angel on TV, right? What TV show? Highway to Heaven? Yeah. Then came the TV show Touched by an Angel. All of that's wrong. I mean, just so that you know. Another misunderstanding is that when you die, dead people become angels. Okay? And so just for the record, when someone dies, including babies, no one becomes an angel. And so our tendency is, just so that you know, I do a very brief introduction, and then we stand and we read the text. Today, I'm going to give a much longer introduction, because today I want to give a little bit of an introduction to just say, let's talk about some facts about angels and what the Bible says about them, because I think that there is some misunderstandings about this. And then we're going to get into the text, where we're going to see in the text that Jesus is greater than angels. And the sermon series is Greater Than, and we're going to find out Jesus is greater than everything. And it happens to be that in Hebrews 1, he's going to talk about at the very early stages that he's greater than angels. So first of all, one fact is that angels are throughout Scripture. They're mentioned over 100 times in the Old Testament. They're more than 160 times in the New Testament. They're found in Genesis chapter 3. It's the first time that they're found. They're found guarding the Garden of Eden in Genesis chapter 3, and then they're found in Revelation 22. They're found from Genesis 3 to Revelation 22. They're basically capstoning Scripture in the beginning and in the end. In most cases, they are invisible and they are innumerable. Now, can they be seen? Yes, because we see people see them. We even will see later in the book of Hebrews that you can entertain angels unaware. And so sometimes you have entertained an angel and you didn't even know you were entertaining an angel. So that's found in this letter that this author has written. One of the places that we find a picture of how that they are innumerable is in Daniel chapter 7. In Daniel 7, it says this. It says, as I looked, thrones were placed, and the Ancient of Days took his seat. That's the Ancient of Days is a reference to God. Ancient of Days took his seat. His clothing was white as snow, the hair of his head like pure wool. His throne was fiery flames. Its wheels were burning fire. A stream of fire issued and came out from before him. 1,000 thousands served him. 10,000 times 10,000 stood before him. The court sat in judgment. The books were open. Well, why are those numbers there? It's because they couldn't count that high. They were innumerable. Later in the book of Revelation, it says this in Revelation chapter 5. It says, then I looked and I heard around the throne and the living creatures and the elders the voice of many angels numbering myriads of myriads and thousands of thousands saying with a loud voice. What were they saying? Worthy is the Lamb who was slain to receive power and wealth and wisdom and might, honor and glory and blessing. Myriads of myriads, thousands of thousands. Something that's not in my notes, but I would remind you that a third of the angels, whatever the third of innumerable is, were cast down, and they're demons today. So sometimes people will say, you see an angel behind every bush, or you see a demon behind every bush. Sometimes I see two or three. There's tons of demons and angelic things that are happening all around us. They're innumerable and they are invisible. Thirdly, angels are immortal. Now, I mean this in this sense. They are created, but they will not die. So they had a beginning. But unlike us, they will not die. God created them, but they are immortal in the sense of that they will not die. The word angel means messenger. It is their primary function. They've been given immense power to accomplish the purpose of being God's messenger. Massive amounts of purpose, of power to accomplish that. Billy Graham said about angels, he called them God's secret agents. I think that's an interesting term. Point next. Angels continuously worship and praise the God they serve. What are angels doing today? They're worshiping the Lord. When you find them in the Old Testament, an example of this is in Isaiah chapter number 6. Isaiah chapter 6, in the year that King Uzziah died, Isaiah said, I saw the Lord sitting on a throne, high and lifted up, and the train of his robe filled the temple. And above him stood the seraphim, angelic beings. Each of them had 6 wings. With 2 he covered his face, and with 2 he covered his feet. With 2 he flew. One called to another and said, what? Holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts, and the whole earth is full of his glory. Next, angels minister to believers. Now, this is going to come up in the passage today. But I think I think one of the things that's interesting is that if you're not a believer, over and over in Scripture, this is like one of the things I've learned this week. I learn something new every week. One of the things I've learned this week, the purpose of angels is for believers, not unbelievers. Angels don't minister to unbelievers, they minister to believers. Psalm 34 in verse number 7 says, the angel of the Lord encamps around who? Those who fear him and delivers them. In Psalm chapter 91 in verse 11 and 12, it says, for he will command his angels concerning you to guard you in all your ways. On their hands they will bear you up, lest you strike your foot against a stone. The poor man, Lazarus, was with the rich man, describing in Luke chapter number 16. And at Lazarus' death, it says, the poor man died and was carried by the angels to Abraham's side. The rich man died and was buried. I've been with a believer in their final deathbed, and I've been there. It's an anecdotal story. I get that. Where a person saw angels. But that fits with Luke 16. And lastly, I would say this. Angels will be used by God at the final judgment. We have a picture, and sometimes it's because of the paintings of angels, that they're cute. But when angels are described in Scripture, they are described as powerful. And in Matthew chapter 13, in verse number 41 and 42, this is God's plan for angels. It says, the Son of Man will send his angels, and they will gather out of his kingdom all causes of sin and all lawbreakers and throw them into the fiery furnace in that place where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. So God's going to use his angels to gather up those to throw them into the lake of fire. This is angels. I read this and I'm like, angels are impressive. This is pretty good right here. However great of ministry this is of angels, it is in no comparison to Jesus. So why is the writer addressing in Hebrews chapter 1, he's going to talk about angels? He's going to talk about them because there were some Jewish believers who were in danger of compromising the idea that Jesus is great, greater than anything else. They were facing persecution from Nero, and they were facing possible ostracism from the synagogue. And they could avoid that if they would say this, Jesus is an angel. Angels are awesome. So why don't you guys just say, Jesus, he's an angel, and that's awesome. And so the author here is saying, no. Jesus is not an angel. He's not like just an angel. Jesus is greater than an angel. He's bigger than that. He's much greater than that. He's much more superior than that. So what does he say? Would you stand with me as we read the word of God, and we'll start in verse 4. Having become as much superior to angels as the name he has inherited is more excellent than theirs. For to which of the angels did God ever say, you are my son, today I've begotten you, or again, I will be to him a father, and he will be to me a son. And again, when he brings me the firstborn into the world, he says, let all God's angels worship him. Of the angels, he says, he makes his angels wind and his ministers a flame of fire. But of the Son, he says, your throne, O God, is forever and ever. The scepter of uprightness is the scepter of your kingdom. You've loved righteousness and hated wickedness. Therefore, God, your God, has anointed you with the oil of gladness beyond your companions. And you, Lord, laid the foundations of the earth in the beginning, and the heavens are the work of your hands. They will perish, but you remain. They will all wear out like a garment, like a robe you'll roll them up. Like a garment they'll be changed. But you are the same, and your years will have no end. And to which of the angels has he ever said, sit at my right hand until I make your enemies a footstool for your feet? Are they not all ministering spirits sent out to serve for the sake of those who are to inherit salvation? Let's pray. Father, I pray in these next few moments your Holy Spirit would give us a picture of your greatness. I thank you for your faithfulness. In Jesus' name, amen. Jesus is greater than angels. Here's the first reason. He has a greater name. Verse 4 and 5. Having become as much superior to angels, and the name he's inherited is more excellent than theirs. Verse 5. For to which of the angels did God ever say, "You're my son, today I've begotten you"? Or again, "I'll be to him a father, and he'll be to me a son"? Jesus has a greater name. We only know three names of three angels in all Scripture. That's it. Michael, archangel, warrior angel, Gabriel, name of the birth, gave the message of the birth of Jesus, and Lucifer, shining ones, what that name means. He would become the son of darkness, Satan. That's the only three names of any angels in all of Scripture. Out of the myriads and myriads of angels there are, we know three. That's it. Let me tell you, we know one name that's above every other name. It's the name of Jesus. Never forget his name is above it all. And it's not that name that's being used in verse 5. Watch verse 5. For to which of the angels did God ever say? And he quotes Psalm 2:7. You are my son. I have two sons. It's not a fair comparison. The only part of this fair comparison would be, my sons matter more to me than you do. That's the only fair comparison. Here we're talking about Son of God. And we're not talking about son as in Jesus was born and had never existed. He was always and will always be. We're talking about son as in title. That is all. He is the Son of God. He says, what angel ever had that title? He says at the end of verse number 7, or again, I'll be to him a father and shall be to me a son. Another quotation in 2 Samuel chapter 7 and verse 14. No angel was ever called a son. Never has happened. Leighton Ford, evangelist and brother-in-law of Billy Graham, once met Muhammad Ali at a hotel in Sydney, Australia. Leighton Ford listened as Muhammad Ali was talking to all of the onlookers, recognizing he was with Leighton Ford, the brother-in-law of Billy Graham. Muhammad Ali's face lit up as he said, "Oh, Billy, I love Billy. I went up to his house in Montreat. He signed a book for me." Leighton Ford explained what happened next. He said, "We got into a very interesting conversation." Muhammad Ali was very articulate. He was a very bright man. Earlier in his life, Muhammad Ali had become a Muslim. He told me and the onlookers, "You know, I've traveled all over the world. I've seen all these different religions. It seemed to me they all have the same thing. It's kind of like you have a river, you have a lake, you have a pond, you have a stream. They all have water in them. So they're all the same, aren't they, Leighton?" I said, "Muhammad, that's very interesting. But suppose you have all of them, and suppose they're all polluted. Then you would need a purifier, don't you? You see, that's who Jesus is. Jesus is the purifier." You could see him thinking. Muhammad said, "That's good. I've never thought about it quite like that. Jesus, the purifier." Leighton Ford said, "I know that Muslims don't refer to Jesus as the Son of God because they interpret that in some physical way, that God had relations with Mary. Of course, isn't true." I told him, "Did you know that in the Bible, Jesus is called the second Adam?" He said, "I did not know that." "Yes, you see, there was a first Adam that God made in the first creation. The second Adam was Jesus, in whom through everyone can become new." Muhammad said, I got to think about that. That was 30 years ago when this was written. I haven't seen him since then. He would say, "I am the greatest." But every great one passes away. And when they do, they go face to face with the one who is the greatest. is the greatest name. He's the Son of God. He has the greatest honor. Look in verse 6. And again, when he brings the firstborn into the world, he said, let all God's angels worship him. Jesus is worshiped by angels. I think that's important. So remember, what they're trying to do is they're trying to get these Hebrew believers to say Jesus is an angel. But then he says in verse 6, let all God's angels worship him. If you worship an angel, you'd be rebuked by the angel unless the angel's demonic. You say, well, prove that. Okay. Revelation chapter 22 says this. John, who wrote it, says, I, John, am the one who heard and saw these things, and when I heard and saw them, I fell down to worship at the feet of the angel who showed them to me. But he, the angel, said to me, don't do that. I'm a fellow servant with you and your brothers, the prophets, and with those who keep the words of this book. Worship God. Angels know. Don't worship me. Worship God. He's greater. He has honor. And they've known that since the beginning. When Jesus first came to this earth, what happened? Luke chapter 2, and suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of heavenly hosts praising God and saying, glory to God in the highest and on earth, peace among those with whom he's pleased. Third, look in verse 7, 8, and 9. Jesus has a greater status of the angels, he says. He makes his angels winds and his ministers a flame of fire. But of the Son, he says, your throne, O God, is forever and ever. The scepter of uprightness is the scepter of your kingdom. You have loved righteousness and hated wickedness. Therefore, God, your God, has anointed you with the oil of gladness beyond your companions. Verse number 7, angels are servants. Son of God is sovereign. Psalm 104, verse number 4, is quoted about angels. He makes his messengers winds, his ministers a flaming fire. Angels sometimes spectacularly inhabit wind and fire to do God's request. But more importantly than the symbolism of wind and fire, notice this word in verse 7. He makes his angels wind. He makes his ministers of wind. Who has the angels? They're his angels. He has them. Then you get to verse 8 and 9. But of the Son, he says, your throne, the scepter of uprightness, verse 9, has anointed you. These are a quotation out of Psalm 45, verse 6 and 7. In Psalm 45, it says this, your throne, O God, is forever and ever. The scepter of your kingdom is a scepter of uprightness. You've loved righteousness and hated wickedness. Therefore, God, your God, has anointed you with the oil of gladness beyond your companions. I don't know if you've noticed in the book of Hebrews, we're showing you a lot of passages in the Old Testament because all of these are quotations. He keeps quoting the Old Testament because these Hebrew believers, they know their Bible. So the author keeps quoting the Old Testament. What you and I need to see is just that. Notice these words within verse 8 and 9, the words throne, scepter, and anointing. They're all terms referring to his sovereignty. The word throne, his rule will never end. Scepter, his authority will be executed in righteousness. His anointing, a king would be anointed. And here he's anointed with an oil of joy. Angels may take all kinds of forms, form of wind, form of fire, whatever. But whatever form they're in, they're simply servants of the king. Jesus is not a servant. He's the king. Look at verse 10 through 12. And you, Lord, laid the foundation of the earth in the beginning, and the heavens are the work of your hands. They will perish, but you remain. They will all wear out like a garment. Like a robe, you will roll them up. Like a garment, they will be changed. You are the same. Your years will have no end. Jesus has a greater existence. How? writer quotes Psalm 102, verses 25 through 27. That's what you see here. It's what the passage that has been interlaid in this passage. And what he's saying within this passage is he's making clear angels are dependent on God. This earth, the Lord created. This earth, creation is dependent on God. Creation constantly changes. This is September. Is it? It is September. Soon it will be October. And soon, November. And every month right now, the leaves will change. And December comes. Cold. Some of you love cold. You are weird. Some of you love cold. January comes. No leaves, unless it's an evergreen. Everything changes right now. Do you see this? Verse 12. Like a robe, you'll roll them up. You know what that's not talking about? Changing of seasons. You know what that is talking about? One of these days, God's going to take all of creation, he's going to roll it up, he's going to throw it away. And then he's going to make it new again. And you know one thing that will never change? Oh, creation will change. But the Creator, look at the end of verse number 12. You are the same. And your years, Lord, will have no end. Mine will. I was born 1970. I don't know when my end date is, but I'll have one. I'll have one. Right now I'm living the dash. So are you. I'm in my dash right now. But he has no end. Rest in that. Last thing. Watch it. Look at verse 13 and 14. And to which of the angels has he ever said, sit in my right hand till I make your enemies a footstool for your feet? Are they not all ministering spirits sent out to serve for the sake of those who are to inherit salvation? He says, what angel have I ever said sit at the right hand of God? Hopefully you can hear from the author here some sarcasm. Like, really? Are we going to give the right hand of God a place for the angels? No, that's for the Son. Christ rules. Angels serve. That's what this is about. Christ rules, angels serve. Christ sits at the right hand, and all of the enemies will be at his footstool. He's in charge. He's the boss. And what will happen with angels? Look at verse 14. They are ministering spirits sent out to serve who? For the sake of those of you who are followers of Jesus this morning, for you who inherit salvation, they come alongside you. That's who. But every angel one day will bow before God. I'm reminded in Philippians chapter 2. This is what the passage says in Philippians chapter 2, verse number, 9 through 11. It says this: therefore God has highly exalted him, speaking of Jesus, and bestowed on him the name that is above every name, so that at the name of Jesus, watch this, every knee should bow. In heaven? Who? I don't think that's just us. I think that's every angel. Why would I think that? Watch how the passage continues. And on earth and under the earth, every demon, every angel, every person will all bow their knees before God one day. There's only one ruler. There's only one king. He's boss. He's creator. He deserves to be worshiped, and no one else. See, I think what we've now done is we've forgotten the news of the gospel goes, in a lot of people's minds, it goes something like this. Well, if I do 1,000 good deeds, and then I do 900 stupid stuff, my math says I'm still plus 100. I'm good. I mean, that's how honestly, when I was a kid, I would literally, even though I went to a church that taught the gospel, I would literally be in my bed and ask myself, did I do more good things or bad things today? And this is how my little brain worked. And I came to the conclusion, I was a pretty good kid. I know that's hard for y'all to believe, but I was a pretty good kid. Here's the problem with this. You do 1,000 good things, and you do one bad thing, with an attitude, with a thought, or with an action, your account, if you would, is overdrawn. You don't have a positive 100. It's overdrawn. And it's just closed. You have no hope. What does Christ do? Cross. That's what he does. And here's what's crazy. He doesn't just do this for this. He does this for this. All your good stuff, he died for that too. All those times I went to church, all my moral decisions, he saved me from myself. Jesus is greater than everything. Rest in that. And so, like in a few moments, we're going to participate with communion, the Lord's Supper. You can participate. If you've put your faith in Jesus, you know without question that you've called on him, asked him to come into your life, to forgive you of your sins, to save you. But if you don't know, I would ask you, don't. That communion is for those of you in this room who you have called on the Lord and asked him to save you. And I would also say, for those of you who are here, who maybe you are a Christian, but if you're struggling with people that you need to reconcile with, don't take communion, just pause this Sunday. Just pause. And you'll reconcile. Go reconcile. And I would say that if you have not put your faith in Christ, the best idea, rather than not taking communion, is let's put our faith in Christ right now. Would you bow your heads with me? The hope of the gospel is that we can call on the Lord today, right now, and recognize that he saves us. He changes our lives. So I would ask you today, right now, call on the Lord. Ask him to come into your life, to forgive you of your sin, Let him know you need him. I don't have a special prayer for you to pray. I just want you to know that if you call on the Lord, you ask him to forgive you, he will. He'll save you. Jesus died on the cross for your sins. You have an opportunity today to call on him. And I want to encourage you to do that. For those of you who are followers of Christ today, let's remember his greatness. Father, I love you and I thank you for loving us. And I pray that, Lord, we would have a clear picture of how great you are. You're the King. You rule. You're the sovereign. You're the Savior. And nothing else is in comparison to you. Thank you for you. I come to you today in the strong name of Jesus. It's in his name I pray. Amen. In the back of the room, there are two tables of communion elements. And in the front of the room, there are two tables. And if you would like to participate with communion, you can just go. You can grab both the bread and the juice. It's all in one. Just bring it back to your seat. And when you bring it back to your seat, just hang on. For the next few minutes, we're just going to worship the Lord privately. And in a few minutes, I'm going to read some text and I'll give you instructions about how we'll take communion together as a church. But in the next few seconds, few moments, if you want to participate, just go and grab the elements and bring it back to your seat whenever you're ready to do so. Piece of plastic at the very top. You can peel back and get to the bread and then hold the bread in your hand. Isaiah 53, it says this: surely he has borne our griefs and carried our sorrows, yet we esteemed him stricken, smitten by God, and afflicted. He was pierced for our transgressions, he was crushed for our iniquities. Upon him was the chastisement that brought us peace. With his wounds we are healed. All we like sheep have gone astray. We've turned everyone to his own way, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. In 1 Corinthians chapter 11, I want you to listen to each word of this. Paul says, For I received from the Lord what I delivered to you. The Lord Jesus, on the night when he was betrayed, he took bread. Pause there. On the night he was betrayed, have you two things. Have you noticed this is not a great time culturally? We're in a pandemic. Former staff member here at Northwoods, associational coordinator here in our area, Ed Collins, has COVID and is on a ventilator. I think of that. I think of that. That culturally, this is a hard time. Then I think of some of you have walked in here today, and you've not personally maybe been betrayed, but you're hurting. Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, he took bread, and then it says this. Watch it. He gave thanks. He gave thanks. So I want you to look at your bread, and I want you to think to yourself, what are you thankful for? Can't be thankful for anything else, you can be thankful for Jesus. And he broke it, and he said this, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Let's take this together. Peel the rest back and get to your juice. Your neighbor is struggling, you can help them if they'll let you. The book of Hebrews says, without the shedding of blood, there is no forgiveness of sins. Paul says, in the same way, he took the cup after supper, and he said, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." Let's drink this together. You can. The very next verse says, "For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death till he comes." Watch that. Every time we participate with the Lord's Supper, we're saying, he died and he's coming. It's not possible for him to come again except that he didn't stay dead. Jesus is alive. I said, Jesus is alive. Okay, we can celebrate every time we have communion that I didn't do that. We can celebrate every time we have communion that we have a risen Savior. And we should. We have a reason to celebrate. And the reason we have to celebrate is not simply a death, a life. A life. Jesus is alive. It is true that I feel like there is a lot of hardships, a lot of hard things going on in life. But what I would say to you, in the midst of a lot of hard things that are going on in life, one thing never changes. One thing will never change. Jesus. Amen. Keep your eyes on Jesus. Jesus. He's alive. He's coming again. He's in control. He's the only king. He's the sovereign one. Put your eyes on Jesus. Stand with me. We'll sing this final song. Glad you're here today.
One day you'll make everything new, Jesus. One day you will bind every wound. The former things shall all pass away. No more tears. One day you'll make sense of it. Question resolved. Every anxious thought left behind. No more fear. When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. When we all
boxes at the board. You can drop your connect cards there. Hope they have a good rest of the day, and we'll see you next week. All right, thanks.